Hey everyone, in the past few months I've built lots of different computers, from mini ITX all the way up to ATX, and I've got some thoughts about which is the best form factor. And I know the best, you know, there's no such thing, it's personal choice. Like if you want, you know, a big case with lots of expansion options, then ATX is a really good option. Whereas if you want a small portable build, mini ITX is really good. And then if you don't want expansion capability or portability, you can get micro ATX. So in this video, I wanted to give my general thoughts about the different form factors and what you need to know when choosing which one to build in. But first, thanks to ORICO for sponsoring this video. The IG740 Pro is a brilliant NVMe drive with a really blingy heatsink, and it's got good thermal performance too. What sets this drive apart is this got loads of extra features for enhanced data security, which is really nice. Inside the box, you've got the NVMe drive, the blingy heatsink, a thermal pad, a screw, and a screwdriver, and it's easy enough to install. You just slot it in, screw it in, and then boot up your system. In terms of the speed results, it will vary depending on your exact motherboard and chipset, but this is actually the fastest Gen 4 NVMe drive I've ever tested. So if you like bling and fast speeds, ORICO might be a thing. Check out the links in the description. Right, so let's start off with mini ITX, because you can get loads of power nowadays from a mini ITX build, but still have it take up barely any space on your desk and be, you know, shorter than your monitors, which is really cool. But mini ITX, one of the big downsides of it is a lack of choice and the expense of everything. Because if, for example, you wanted an ASRock B850 motherboard right now at the time of filming, a mini ITX one might set you back around £181, whereas an ATX one is around £150. And you see that, you know, with different manufacturers, and whether you go with, you know, Intel or B550 or whatever, you see that generally across the board. Like often you can pay hundreds of pounds for a mini ITX case because they are a bit more specialist and niche. And I guess niche is the key word there, because in addition to price, you know, there's just less choice. For example, when I built this mini ITX build, I wanted a white AM5 motherboard because I had an AM5 CPU. And actually there was only a single white AM5 motherboard, which kind of blew my mind because AM5 has been out for ages. And, you know, I know that white is less common than other types of builds, but in general, you'd think you'd have more than one white AM5 option in the entire world. So yeah, that was a bit of a pain, and I ended up spending over £300 on that particular motherboard. I went for the Aorus Pro Ice X870i, which is an absolutely stunning looking motherboard. But yeah, you do have to pay a bit of a tax if you do want to go with mini ITX. You can have less choice and it's going to be more expensive, so that is worth knowing. And also, whilst I say it's a really, you know, pretty looking motherboard, there are some quirks with it. For example, there was only one system fan header, which is actually incredibly annoying. When I installed some extra fans to cool down my GPU, and cooling is an issue, I'll talk about that in a minute, but when I installed some extra fans, I didn't have any spare headers, and I didn't really want to get a fan hub, because that means extra power cables and everything else, and extra space inside your already small case. So basically, yeah, I just wanted to run all the fans off the fan headers on the motherboard, and I didn't have enough. So in the end, I just hijacked the CPU pump header for my two GPU intake fans, which is a bit of a pain, but sometimes you've got to do things like that with mini ITX builds. Equally, because the PCB on mini ITX is so small, you might have issues with the actual layout of things. For example, the front panel audio header on this is actually raised up like some weird half-breed header, so it is a bit weird. Equally, this particular motherboard has a second M2 NVMe slot, like many modern motherboards, and actually it's on the back of the motherboard. And that's not too unusual, but I recently built in a case that blocked off that second M2 NVMe slot. So if I ever wanted to change that M2 drive or it failed or whatever, I'd actually have to take out my motherboard from the standoffs in order to change that, which is a little bit annoying. But it is worth knowing that you're going to have some weird, awkward layout choices when building with mini ITX. The next thing you need to be aware of is that the I/O that's actually offered on the motherboard might not be as good as with micro ATX and ATX options. You're probably going to get less USB support and things like that. And actually, I'm lucky in this one, it's not too bad, but you're still, you know, when compared to like an ATX motherboard, you can see there's a significant difference between the amount of connectivity. And it kind of makes sense because the motherboard is physically smaller. You can't just pack too much into it. But you need to be aware of that, because when building in a mini ITX case, in general, you know, it is more complicated. Like the case itself, sometimes you need to actually build it around your computer build. And that sounds fun and some people enjoy that, but actually sometimes that can be quite difficult as well. And I'd say that if you are a first-time computer builder, you might not want, you know, to start off with mini ITX, or especially in one of the cases I just mentioned. Like this isn't too bad, the Corsair 2000D. It's a little bit bigger, I think it's 25 liters, which some people criticize, but actually building in here isn't too bad, but it's still a lot harder building in a case like this than like, you know, a full tower ATX case. You're gonna have so much more room with that. and the motherboard's going to be more spaced out, and as a result, it's just easier to build in like an ATX build. So I think if you are a first-time system builder, I'd probably get like a mid-tower ATX case and motherboard and build in that. And I know I'm being quite critical here, mini ITX is actually my favorite form factor. Like, I love this particular build. It's all white and it fits on my desk so nicely. So I do really like it as a form factor, but just in general, you know, yeah, you do need to be aware of the fact that it can be quite annoying to build in it. And even once you've finished your build and it's all up and running, you'll find that it'll probably run hotter than, you know, a micro ATX or an ATX build, just because there's not as much cooling potential and things like that. Equally, if you need to upgrade or change a part, that can be a complete pain. Like in this particular case, I need to take out like 5 or 6 fans before I can access like my CPU cooler or, you know, some of my motherboard headers and things like that. Next, I wanted to talk about ATX because everything is easier here, apart from, you know, actually fitting the case on your desk. Like, often they can be really, really big, but in general there's more choice and the pricing is better with ATX. So if you're looking at a motherboard, I gave the example earlier, but you know, it might be £30 or £40 or dollars cheaper from the same manufacturer. You know, if you're comparing like for like, then yeah, it will be cheaper with ATX. Equally, it's quite nice when you're looking at the ATX motherboard, it's quite nice just how much connectivity and header options there are. Like, often you might have 3, 4, or 5 system fan headers, and you'll have more, you know, SATA ports and all the other headers as well. You can have more of them, and you might also get thermistor headers, which can be quite useful for custom loop builds. And also, if you want to monitor like your 12 volt power connector, that can be quite useful. And often you find thermistor headers and higher end ATX motherboards. You don't see that as much on like higher end mini ITX motherboards, for example. But what's also important to know is I mentioned that you're going to have more, you know, connectivity on an ATX motherboard, and you might get one with like 4 or 5 N2 NVMe drives for your storage, and that is a very good thing. But actually, always check the specification page for that motherboard, because ultimately consumer CPUs only have a certain number of free PCI Express lanes, often 24, and your graphics card takes 16 of them. And I won't get too technical here, but what this actually means in practice is that you might not have enough free PCI Express bandwidth on your motherboard to support more than, you know, 2 or 3 additional M2 NVMe drives. So if you were planning on having 5 NVMe drives, you might actually find that, you know, some of your SATA ports get disabled, or your M2 drives actually run at like Gen 3 speeds instead of Gen 4. And that also applies to the PCI Express slot. So the top one will often be X16. In fact, it nearly always is. But then if your motherboard has a second X16 slot, what you might find is it's not actually an X16 slot. So physically it is, but then electrically, it's actually like an X4 slot or an X2 slot. And what that means is if you bought like a second graphics card and you were hoping to put it in that second slot and run at like X16 bandwidth, you're not going to have that. And I've been caught out by this myself. I bought an ATX motherboard, a B550 from Gigabyte, and that second slot was actually only X2. So when I installed my capture card in it, it actually ran a lot slower and my game footage was really choppy, which was really annoying. And I'm not going to talk about, you know, motherboard limitations too much in this video, because this is more about form factors, but I have got another video where I dive into this in more detail if you wanted to check that out. But what I should also say with ATX is that actually just building in it in general is a lot easier. For example, if you needed to install top fans or change your top fans with an ATX case and motherboard as well, you're often going to have more room, but you're not going to be able to do that with like a mini ATX case. Everything's going to be more limited there. And on that note, you're often going to get a lot more cooling potential with ATX cases. For example, they might support 2 or 3 radiators. And I know I mentioned with mini ATX, you can get a lot of power and you can have a build like that in mini ATX, but it's just harder to keep everything cool. And you might actually need to get down to sort of 3D printing shrouds for your cooling with a mini ATX build, but with an ATX build, it's a lot easier to just buy a case that has a lot more cooling flexibility and potential. So for me, that is a clear win of ATX cases. There are some downsides to ATX builds though, and I know I've covered some of them already, but actually one of the big ones is the extra weight and the size of them. For example, this particular desk is 140 centimeters, so whilst it's not insanely massive, it's also not that small either. Like, you could have a lot smaller desks, but what I actually find is, because I like having 2 monitors for my video editing, I can't actually fit an ATX case on this desk, but I can fit a mini ATX case. So for me, I actually find that, you know, ATX is just a bit too big and bulky for that. And that's where micro ATX could possibly come in. Like, I've criticized micro ATX quite a lot in a previous video and also in the intro here, but actually micro ATX does in some cases have the best of both worlds. Like, it's not very flexible in terms of customization, and I'll touch on that point in a minute, but it is easier to build in than mini ITX, and it's also fairly portable compared to like ATX. So yeah, micro ATX, it's in between mini ITX and ATX. It's kind of obvious, but you know, I'll put the specs on the screen now with the exact dimensions, and you can actually see that like a micro ATX motherboard does have a lot more options and connectivity compared to a mini ITX motherboard, for example. So that's great. One thing I haven't mentioned there though in that graphic was actually the case, because you can get some cases like the Sama IM01 or the Mechanic Master C26, if I remember correctly, that are actually smaller than this particular case. So, you know, with micro ATX, as long as it can fit the motherboard, then it's obviously a micro ATX case. But you can actually get some really, really small micro ATX cases as well. But then you get the benefit of the increased connectivity options on the motherboard. And also, micro ATX motherboards tend to have a lot more choice and availability, and hence better pricing than mini ITX, which is obviously a good thing. And equally with micro ATX, you're more likely to get motherboards that support like 5 gigabit Ethernet compared to like mini ITX, where I don't think I've ever seen a mini ITX motherboard that supports 5 gigabit Ethernet. I guess the reason I criticize micro ATX though is that in general the builds are not going to be as small or as portable as a mini ITX build. I mean, this isn't a great example of a mini ITX build because it's quite a big case, but in general, you know, mini ITX builds are going to be a lot more portable. But when you come to micro ATX, although you are going to have slightly more room inside the case, you're still going to be limited in terms of upgradability. For example, a micro ATX motherboard might have a second PCI Express slot, but that PCI Express slot might not be accessible because it's going to be squished a bit closer to the top slot. And if you've got a graphics card in there, then actually that graphics card, if it's even a 2.5 slot GPU, is probably going to cover that second PCI Express slot. So one of the potential benefits of micro ATX is that you've got more customization options than mini ITX, but sometimes you don't. So in my mind, micro ATX is a slightly weird form factor. It is nice, like if you're doing your first build, it is nice to have a fairly compact form factor, but still have an easier build overall than a mini ITX case. But equally, in general, it's going to be a bigger build than the smallest possible mini ITX builds. So you don't have that advantage, and then you don't have some of the clear advantages of the ATX form factor either. But I'm not trying to troll anyone. I know that some people really like micro ATX, and I'd be eager to hear your thoughts. You know, whatever form factor you prefer, please drop me a comment, and it'd be good to get some discussions going about, you know, the pros and cons of different form factors. And if you enjoyed this video, please click the thumbs up button and please subscribe to see more videos like this. Thanks for watching.